Please be upstanding for the arrival of the official party.
Ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellency, in welcoming you all here this evening to this special occasion to celebrate the Platinum Jubilee of Her Majesty the Queen, can I on your behalf extend an especially warm welcome to Her Excellency the Governor of Victoria, the Honourable Linda Dessau, who is also at the moment Administrator of the Commonwealth of Australia, as the longest serving governor having taken office in 2015, and to her husband, Mr. Anthony Howard, a very warm welcome. So we have in effect tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the Governor of Victoria and the Governor General of Australia present this evening. Can I also welcome the Secretary of the Council of British and Commonwealth Societies, Julie Sattler, who also represents the Australia-Britain Society and the Royal Society of St George, as well as being Assistant Treasurer with the Royal Overseas League. You wonder where she has spare time. Can I welcome Norman Kennedy, the Treasurer of the Council of British and Commonwealth Societies, who also represents the Australia Day Council, Brian Sturton Gill, the President of the Monarchist League in Australia Victorian Chapter, Marissa Barter Waters, President of the Victoria Day Council, and the next chair of the Council of British and Commonwealth Societies. And a warm welcome to former council members Elizabeth Mark and John Clark. Also, I'd like to welcome, although I haven't seen her, Frances Nichols. No, maybe not. Right. Okay, she might be still coming, but then she was hoping to be here. Very pleased to see Lady Potter, who I think I'd be suggesting has probably been presented to the Queen more often than anyone else in this room. There are a few apologies I'd like to mention. The Right Honourable the Lord Mayor of Melbourne, Councillor Sally Capp, the Right Reverend and Honourable Peter Hollingworth, the Honourable Dr. Kay Patterson, who's a past Vice President of the Royal Overseas League Victorian Branch, and especially an apology from Mr. Ron Williamson, who is in fact the President of the Royal Overseas League Victorian Branch and happens to be in Darwin at the moment, so has asked me to carry out tonight's function on his behalf, part of it anyway. Also apologies from Patricia McKendrick, Iona McKinnon, Christine Thompson and Anastasia Malashev, and John and Elaine King. It's a great pleasure to welcome Her Majesty's 11th Governor of Victoria and her husband to tonight's celebration, especially as Her Excellency is also the Administrator of the Commonwealth of Australia, and you might have noticed that the flag is slightly different that's flying at Government House, not the Governor's flag or the Victorian Governor's flag, but the Australian flag, and that's why, as the Administrator. The Governor is the State Patron of the Royal Overseas League and other loyal societies, and the Governor General is the Australian Patron of the League, and Her Majesty is the worldwide patron. If I could quote Her Excellency's impressive speech at the first marvellous celebration of the Platinum Jubilee given at Government House on the 3rd of February, as Queen of Australia, Her Majesty's reign has thus far seen 16 Prime Ministers and 14 premiers of Victoria, 16 visits to Australia, including 11 to Victoria, and many auspicious events. which included the lighting of the Eternal Flame at our Shrine of Remembrance, the opening of Victoria's 39th Parliament in 1954, and the opening of not one but two Royal Children's Hospital buildings, the original one in 1963 and the current one in 2011. Her Majesty has given 70 years of selfless service to Australia and the Commonwealth. She is now the second longest reigning monarch of all time in the world. And Louis the 14th, watch out. And let's not forget who was by her side for 69 of those years, Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh. As Her Majesty said 20 years ago, my strength and stay all these years. The celebrations in London represented a tribute to a lifetime of service and were enjoyed by millions around the globe. May Her Majesty continue to reign over us for some time to come. Please welcome Her Excellency the Honourable Linda Dassault, Governor of Victoria and Administrator of the Commonwealth of Australia.
Well, how very economical it is to get two of your patrons in one person this evening. Can I say, Jason, thank you so much for that introduction, and I wonder if anyone would be terribly bereft if I didn't repeat all the acknowledgements, by way of concession to the shortness of life. Could I also start, though, by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we are gathering this evening and by paying my respects to elders past and present and to elders of other communities who might be with us. Tony and I are absolutely delighted to join you here this evening to celebrate such a wonderful occasion as the Platinum Jubilee of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. I think we'd all agree that when we say we're delighted to be anywhere at the moment, we all really mean it. There's nothing quite like a global pandemic to make that old cliche have a great deal of feeling and emotion when we say it. I do want to say at the outset too, as patron of the Victorian branch, I am pleased for the opportunity once again to recognise the work of the Royal Overseas League in promoting international friendship and understanding throughout the Commonwealth and the work of the organisations represented here this evening. And of course it gives me enormous pleasure to be honouring Her Majesty and her long-standing service here with all of you in this way. Everybody knows who is in this room that Her Majesty ascended the throne on the 6th of February 1952. Many of us have known about it for all our lives, in fact. Across the 70 years since, so much has happened in the world. So much has changed, whether it's culturally, technologically or politically. Humans have, across that time, gone into space for the first time and invented the internet. The first successful heart transplant was done, and the first mammal was successfully cloned in Dolly the sheep, if we all think back to that. Interestingly, the Berlin Wall across that time was built and then torn down, and civil rights were fought for and slowly gained. Certainly, world leaders across that time have come and gone, and world orders have shifted and changed. And for every single one of those and many other milestones, Her Majesty has been there. Her service and her leadership have been a constant in the lives of those in the United Kingdom, the Commonwealth and Australia. While reflecting on changes, so much has also changed in the United Kingdom across Her Majesty's reign. Joining the EU, unjoining the EU, decades of the Troubles and then the Good Friday Agreement, the first female Prime Minister, and you think of immigration and the changes to the face of the nation in which Her Majesty has been ruling. So much has changed in the Commonwealth too, something uppermost, I must say, in our minds as we set off shortly for the Commonwealth Games in Birmingham in preparation to celebrate the Commonwealth Games being here in Victoria in 2026, something that right across the state, throughout regional Victoria, we'll be really looking forward to. And of course, countries have joined the Commonwealth, countries have left the Commonwealth, countries have rejoined the Commonwealth. So much has changed too in Australia. In 1954, there was something like 95% of us identifying as British. And you think of how different that is today. It's markedly different. And tellingly, more than a quarter of us speak a language other than English at home. In fact, it was interesting in this morning's paper looking at some of the census results from last year. Although it is round about a quarter speaking a language other than English at home across Australia, in Victoria, we do know that we are multicultural because it's closer to 30%, in fact. So too, the way we're governed has changed. Since the Australia Acts of 1986, the remaining possibilities for the UK to legislate with effect in Australia, for the UK to be involved in Australian government, and for an appeal from any Australian court to a British court have all disappeared. So there's been very significant changes. But again, Her Majesty's leadership and constancy has woven its way through such significant events and changes. Something else has woven its way through them as well, and that's the universal admiration for her service. There are those in the world, realistically, for whom the British Crown holds no direct relevance or influence. Realistically, there are some who specifically don't support our system of a constitutional monarchy. But there are very, very few people who would not be in awe of Her Majesty's commitment to service. The longest of a British monarch, and the longest in known history, Jason, of any female head of state. It's not a service that can be measured by numbers alone, but numbers do serve to provide a context of sorts, a sort of snapshot into the role that has defined the Queen's public life. Now, Jason, you did mention some of them, but let me just reiterate a few and add some. Across her seven decades as Queen, Her Majesty has seen 14 Prime Ministers of the United Kingdom. She's performed the state opening of Parliament 67 times, and she's given royal assent to some 3,500 different bills. As Queen of Australia, as you mentioned, Her Majesty's seen 16 Prime Ministers, 14 Premiers, and 11 Governors of our state. I'm the 29th Governor of Victoria, so it's an extraordinary accomplishment when you think about it, that Her Majesty has reigned through the time that 11 governors have been here. Our terms have varied in length. I've discovered that we actually last longer than premiers, so that's good. But chief justices seem to last much longer than we do, so I'm not sure what that means. None of that can even begin, though, to measure, can you imagine, the number of events hosted and attended, the people she's met, or the hands that she's shaken. In my time as governor across the past 7 years, I'm not sure if I've even achieved a mere 10% of those handshakes. Now, we have had COVID in between, so that lowers my numbers, I know. But it certainly has given me enough of a glimpse to particularly commend the stamina displayed by Her Majesty across the full 70 years. Now, recently we saw the documentary Queen Elizabeth, A Portrait in Parts, and I'm not sure if any of you have yet seen it. It's wonderful, and I particularly enjoyed the humanity that shone through via the very, very clever footage that was curated there. We saw Her Majesty's natural humour, her joy of family, her genuine passion for horses and racing, and her legendary capacity to put people at ease. The latter is something that Tony and I, on less occasions than Lady Potter, have had the privilege to experience firsthand. Indeed, the dry wit for which Her Majesty is renowned is often a little self-deprecating and specifically directed to putting anyone around her at ease. Now, I'm not going to recount any stories of our time with Her Majesty, that would be improper, but there is, of course, the well-known story where it's said that when a member of the public spotted Her Majesty and told her she looked just like the Queen, the Queen's response was simply, "How reassuring." Her Majesty has, of course, visited Australia many times, as we've heard. Her first trip was in 1954. I'm pleased to say I don't quite remember it, but I do remember all the ones since. And it was the first by a reigning monarch, so it was really a very important and significant one. It was an extensive and successful tour. Literally millions of people flocked to see the young Queen and Prince Philip as they visited 57 towns and cities during their 58 days here. In Bendigo alone, nearly 100,000 people lined the streets to catch a glimpse of the couple. When I looked at that, I reflected on the first glimpses that I had had of Her Majesty as a child, waiting for what seemed like hours and probably was hours. I suspect everybody in this room's had similar experiences that they could recount from childhood through, and the extraordinary excitement when you saw the Queen passing by. The trip back in 1954 included some of the important moments that have been mentioned. Her Majesty's visited Victoria on 11 occasions in total, and of course the Royal Children's Hospital has been open not once but twice, which is quite an accomplishment. Her Majesty, of course, has seen many major events in our state. Now, many of my predecessors have hosted Her Majesty on those visits, and no doubt many of you this evening, as I said, have treasured memories of even being presented to her or attending events in her presence. And Her Majesty's commitment and dedication to her life of service, I think we would all agree, is absolutely admirable. For that, for her leadership and for her steady hand, and for her warmth and her wisdom too, I think we can all be grateful. On her Platinum Jubilee year, Her Majesty has said that she looks ahead with a sense of hope and optimism. Well, I think we can say that we share that with her, and we wish Her Majesty good health and happiness in the years ahead. Can I conclude by thanking the Royal Overseas League, all those at the Victorian branch, and all those connected with the Council of British and Commonwealth Societies for your efforts in putting together this dinner this evening. It's a very fitting tribute and celebration to Her Majesty, and I thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency, for a marvellous speech, and more will be said about that later. But at this point, I'd like to call on Vice President Jean Black to say grace.
God bless this food to our use and us to thy service. And in this special year, let's remember also, as we have heard tonight, Her Majesty as she goes forward into another year. Thank you.
Amen. Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed that meal as much as I have. I think it was excellent. So I hope you've all enjoyed the lamb in various forms. We're moving on to the program, and you've already had a bit of a taste of what's coming up on the screens at either end of the hall here, or the room. We've got, I don't know, probably Australia's greatest expert at putting things together like this, but Kenneth Park, we're very fortunate that he has put together a magnificent collection of photos and commentary to go with it about the Queen to celebrate her 70 years on the throne. So please welcome Kenneth Park.
Thank you. Governor, Mr. Howard, and Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here this evening to speak on the remarkable reign of Queen Elizabeth II, and long may it continue. Firstly, I do need to apologise to the Governor that I borrowed her fanfare this afternoon because I had a friend calling on me and she was turning 70. So when she walked into my apartment, I pushed the button and the trumpets went, "Shit, oh, where's the Queen?" And possibly the most recognisable person on the planet, you could argue, when you think about the Queen. But I always muse, a friend of mine, and I think I've told this story to some members of the League in years past, was sent a newspaper article from Manchester, and the Queen had been invited to open a special event. And when she had arrived, she lined up with the rest of the people and was greeted, and it was all the formal lines. And the newspaper caught a photograph of the Queen in the line wearing the name tag, Her Majesty the Queen. So she does have a sense of humour. What I've done this evening is literally put together a slideshow with an image from every year of her reign with a few little preliminary slides. And I thought this one was a really sweet slide because it shows a young Princess Elizabeth right in the middle of those terrible war years. And here we see this lovely image of the Queen recording many messages that she recorded over the years, but this is the famous one from Cape Town in South Africa, 1947. "I declare before you all that my whole life, whether it be long or short, shall be devoted to your service and the service of our great imperial family to which we all belong." Of course, there's been a few little changes along the way, but I think we can all say with great honesty, she has served us all well and continues to do so. 1947, Princess Elizabeth riding out from Buckingham Palace for the military parade, the Trooping the Colour, and of course she featured quite prominently for many decades on a horse and later in a carriage. The glorious photograph of 1947 showing the young Princess Elizabeth with Lieutenant Philip Mountbatten. Remember, of course, as he got closer to the moment of marriage, titles started to disappear. It's a wonderful story to see a man who was once a prince become, at one stage, I think he was literally just Mr. for a short time. Then he started collecting them again in his long life. But 2 months before they were actually married, the great crowds in front of Buckingham Palace on the great day, the magnificent parade, and I'm sure one or two of you may have been in London for that. And there they are on the famous balcony, waving to the crowds. Lovely image of Queen Mary and the Queen Mother there too. 1948, she'd done the most important thing in her reign, produce an heir. 1949, it's just a lovely photograph of Philip, Charles and the Queen. Look at that wonderful, ravishing smile. I think we forget that she was a really attractive young woman. She was quite a catch. Dare I say it, Philip was quite a catch as well. 1950, where she's doing her favourite thing, going off to see some sort of horse running around. I think I mentioned in the speech a few weeks ago for the Royal Overseas League. I love that line from Philip when he said was talking about Princess Anne. He said, "Long as it eats, if it eats hay and farts, she'll be happy." She was referring to horses. And I thought I'd show you something rather unusual. This is 1951. Princess Elizabeth, the current Queen, curtsies to His Majesty King Haakon II of Norway. Seven. And it's interesting to recall that, yes, of course, she wasn't queen then, so she wasn't that high in the pecking order. She was moving up it. But she had to do the right thing as a royal. So a lovely curtsy, I must say. She'd get 9 out of 10 for that. And look at this. Isn't that beautiful? 1951. If you look at the Royal Collection, there's lots of images of the Queen, but if you go to the National Portrait Gallery, she is the most photographed, painted individual represented in the collection of the National Portrait Gallery in London. 1952, the Duke and the Queen, sorry, the Princess at that stage, were travelling, as we all know, heading on their grand tour of the world, representing the King, and the news came of his passing. The remarkable first image of Elizabeth returning to the mother country, descending down the stairs from the aircraft, and then the grieving family on one side of the slide. Long may she reign, the proclamation of her ascendancy to the throne, and this beautiful photograph of 1952. She took her job seriously, and she continues to take her job seriously today. And then the celebrated 1953 Cecil Beaton photograph, which broke all conventions of the day, the way in which he superimposed, almost in a way, what we might say, photoshopped her into the scene of the coronation, the great Westminster Abbey. 1954, William Dargy, multiple Archibald Prize winner, paints the famous wattle painting. You'll notice she has wattle on her shoulder in this painting. And of course, many of us would have sat in scout halls, schools, offices, courts, whatever, and that painting would have been reproduced and made available for people to remind them that they were led by this remarkable woman. I believe, according to a friend of mine, the Queen has another copy of it and she keeps it quite close to her. It's one of her favourite portraits. The visit that the Governor referred to, 1954, there they are in the Melbourne cricket ground waving to the crowds. Sir Robert Menzies, 1954, on that visit. Sir Winston Churchill saying goodnight to the Queen. She's been to Downing Street to enjoy a meal. And of course, he was moving out of the political scene at that stage in a direct sense. 1956, who is the greatest star, Marilyn Monroe or the Queen? I have a wonderful photograph in my collection which I found of Elizabeth Taylor behaving like a groupie, trying to take photos of the Queen Mother at the Savoy Hotel. So there is star power there. 1957, the Queen delivers her famous television version of the Christmas message, and the tradition of having all the photographs around the sovereign. They all have meaning and messages. 1958, I imagine they'd clear the traffic for it, but 1959, this is in Chicago, and the Americans are particularly passionate about monarchy, and it's interesting just to remind ourselves, ladies and gentlemen, that this is an open vehicle. Within a few years, of course, we're going to see the devastating consequences of the assassination, the murder of John F. Kennedy. 1960 at Balmoral. And I'm sure you've all heard the story of Balmoral and the security guard walking with the Queen in the grounds, and the American asking, "Oh, have you met the Queen?" And she says, "No, but Dickie has." They all pose for photographs. This is a lovely image of the Queen in her ensemble for the wedding of Princess Margaret. Two glamour couples, the Queen and the Duke, and John F. Kennedy and Jacqueline Kennedy, 1961. The Camelot family. And the Queen in a rather fetching leopard ensemble heading off to the races. And what about this velvet number? 64. I did a talk a few weeks ago and it was all about intimate settings with the Queen, and I somehow found this photograph of all the children, Prince Edward had just been born. And I find this a really remarkable photograph. It's the Queen with Emperor Haile Selassie. Remember that Ethiopia was once an empire. 66, she's on the stamp. Please note the price. And what a beautiful photo from 1967. I think yellow goes very well on the Queen, if you ask me. And this stunning image by Sir Cecil Beaton, 1968. It's a glorious, casual but formal pose of our sovereign. And this really beautiful pairing, I put them together. Cecil Beaton's last portrait of the Queen, he photographed the Queen really for quite a few decades. And it's a remarkable image of her cloaked. And there are lots of paintings which show her wearing often the robes of a particular order. It's quite a popular image amongst artists and photographers. But a lovely scene, the Queen with one of her corgis on the other side for a little bit of contrast. And there she is in 69, wearing the robes of the Order of the... Someone will tell me. I think it's the Order of Bath. By Petro Anagoni. 1970, she does one of her visits to Australia, and this is a very important visit because there's a much more casual air and they really start to promote the whole idea of the royal walkabout. There she is surveying her wonderful estate at Balmoral in 1971. 1972, you see the Queen walking through the Palace of Versailles. Remember, she is a fluent French speaker, and she's walking with President Pompidou, whose name is, of course, commemorated in the great art museum in the centre of Paris. But it's a lovely scene. 73. They say if you have power and you want a friend, get a dog. With the King of Malaysia in 74, it is an endless life of engagements, as we all know. I'm sure our governor knows that as well. But each and every one is interesting and stimulating and memorable. 75 in Japan. It's also interesting to watch the way in which the fashions change. And I think this is one of the most beautiful images. Yeah. Gerald Ford dancing with the Queen in 1976 at the White House. Don't they look as though they're sort of falling for each other? It's just beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. Look at her face. It's honest. And look at his face. 1977, she's in New Zealand. At Epsom, 1978, not shy in coming forward. And there she is with... Baroness Thatcher. It's interesting, I mean, there's been so much written and so many documentaries about their relationship, but as has been noted by the Governor and indeed Jason, she's seen many Prime Ministers come and go, and she's there. She can't do anything about it, and she works with each and every one of them, and I'm sure they all find their own way of working together because that is their responsibility. And this, I call this my Duran Duran moment. 1980, it's of course the Queen, her sister Princess Margaret and the Queen Mother. It's so of its era. 1981, in the early days of the romance between Charles and Diana. It's a long time to go through 70 years of the reign of the Queen, but we're getting there. I'll speed up. 82. What way to break the ice with the President of the United States of America who likes horses but to go riding? They both had a wicked sense of humour. That's 83. And I think the Governor will remember that painting. Yes. It hangs in that lovely long corridor. I think it's a wonderful painting. And doesn't she look lovely in yellow? 85. The Queen is applauding her husband as he's doing a carriage ride. She's obviously delighted. He must be leading. No greater recognition than to be recognised by Andy Warhol, 1985. Negotiating the Great Wall of China, with Diana, 1987, with the then Queen of the Netherlands, Beatrix, of course she's now styled as Princess, aboard the Royal Yacht, 1990, at Balmoral. And Prince Philip, if memory serves me correctly, is wearing the Balmoral tartan. 1991, there she is with George W. Bush Sr., surrounded by some of her prime ministers or ex-prime ministers. And she's quite a shot as well. I like the quizzical look of the officer on the... Don't point it that way, ma'am. And look, and you can, when you look at these images, Boris Yeltsin, I mean, she's been there a long time. She's seen history. It's amazing. Back in New Zealand. There she is with Chirac. Look at the way he's kissing, blowing kisses to the crowd. And Nelson Mandela. Now, two state visits in a year, that's quite an achievement. And of course, 1997, the tragedy of the death of Diana. And that famous scene when the Queen spoke to a grieving nation. Back out on the streets, 1998. Back to the races, 1998. Archbishop Tutu is no longer with us, but had many encounters with the Queen over the years. And doesn't she look dazzling as she's going to a royal gala performance in what would be described in the fashion magazines as a harlequin outfit? 2000, on the balcony with her mother and sister at Buckingham Palace. Gorgeous photo here. Another remarkable woman who believed in the mystery of monarchy. Of course, when the Queen does go to the throne in the sky, Charles's image will appear on the coin, but it will face the other direction. 2002, the Golden Jubilee. This time round we had a sort of hologram of the Queen, which must have pleased her no end. And I put this in because it's symbolic of the Commonwealth. And there are images behind this particular image of the Queen which show scenes from the Commonwealth. And this is part of, you know, the connection which is so important to the Royal Overseas League. And the Commonwealth, I note, took two new members in only recently. And this is painted by an artist from Nigeria. The corgis meet the All Blacks. And said to be one of the Queen's favourite photographs taken by Sophie, Countess of Wessex, in Scotland. There they are enjoying that lovely environment. The Queen... I had to put her in. The Queen with one of her possums. And the famous 2004 photograph of the Queen with obviously gentlemen from the Scottish realm. I noticed we had someone in a kilt tonight. I won't go into this. I've started now. This story has been endlessly photoshopped to reveal much more of a Scotsman than one should really see. I'll move on. Believe it or not, there is actually research done by the United States, UK Statistical Office, which actually breaks down how many people wear underwear and how many people don't wear underwear on their kilts. So I can send the research to the gentleman, actually. I'll send it to you. It's fascinating. 2004, Chris Leven did this remarkable image of the Queen in contemplation, but I thought I needed to contrast that with the Queen in a typical ensemble, which is all about bright colours and being seen. There she is, very late in the time of the life of the Baroness, but, you know, she went to her party. And, of course, that remarkable film of 2006. 2007, we marked the wedding anniversary at Broadlands. And this remarkable set of photographs taken by Annie Leibovitz, which has been the subject of documentaries, but the Queen obviously enjoyed it because she invited her back to take more photographs. That lovely scene from in Buckingham Palace, doesn't that look fabulous? The light is just remarkable. in yellow again. And there she is in a cape in the gardens. I think they're at Buckingham Palace, marching off to the Order of the Garter ceremony, the unveiling of the statue of her mother, 2009. There she is with Obama and Mrs. Obama. Yeah. And Lady Gaga really did a lot to she put the makeup on. But she, look, the Queen had already met Marilyn Monroe, so she could cope with anything. 2010, she joins Facebook, but as the caption said, it said, she's joined Facebook, but she's not going to be your friend. And there she is, 2011, escaping before the inspectors grab her because she ducks up to Government House. The famous James Bond scene. And there she is, 2012, for the Jubilee. And she's with the time. She's off to look at something that involves 3D photography. I do like this. The Four Faces of the Queen. It's done with mirrors by an artist called Hugo Ritson Thomas. And they meet the Pope, and that hamper comes from Balmoral. So I think the Duke's pointing out a very nice bottle of scotch. And look at the look on the Pope's face. Chogham, and the Commonwealth is very close to the heart of the Queen. And then I think I recognise it. Governor, I Googled you, because Google answers everything, you see. So I typed in your name and the Queen, and that's what popped up. And I thought... memories. And then look, there's Mr. Howard coming in. Three steps behind, correct. You know your place, sir. But it's a lovely image, and I think they must be very special memories for you as well. And there's Annie Leibovitz once again with the crop of grandchildren in 2016. But a gorgeous photo of Anne and the Queen. And Anne, I think, is one of the great stalwarts of the royal family. The Princess Royal. And there she is with the little doggies. And there is the line of succession. I like all the oohs and ahs. It's just very nice. And one of the last drives that Prince Philip did when he took Obama and Mrs. Obama through the grounds of Windsor Castle, with all that security and helicopters and guards, etc., they let this ancient gentleman drive the President of the United States of America. You get the real sense of the responsibilities being assumed by the heir apparent, Prince Charles, and the crown, of course, to the left. She has met some interesting people. I'll move on. Oh, she has met some truly interesting people. As someone observed when I showed this slide, Boris Johnson actually combed his hair. And a very, very poignant photograph. A couple that have supported each other. And, of course, we do remember the Duke fondly. I remember him for his wit and his great humour. And that haunting image of the Queen at the funeral service for the Prince by herself. This is very contemporary. I actually managed to get a shot with Prince Louis standing still. Opening the red dispatches box. Obviously, we're coming to the end. Isn't that beautiful? That is just absolutely wonderful. As I said, it's just a little... It's like looking for a family photo album. And I wanted to finish with two images. The young man that you can see standing here is the artist Ralph Hymans, who was commissioned to produce a painting for Westminster Abbey. And that painting is this one. And it's a very poignant image showing the spot where the Queen was crowned. And I find it incredibly moving when you think 70 years on, we remember her service, and we look forward to her continued service in whatever form it takes. But I think it must have been a very, very interesting encounter to actually have the Queen come in as well and be in the Abbey to just do a few sketches, etc. Quite wonderful. But really, in a sense, I should leave the last few words to the Queen. And I just simply want to say it's delightful to be here tonight. It's very nice to see the Governor and Mr. Howard, who I know quite well through a whole range of machinations. But your words were lovely.
Now, Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, I mean, that was a brilliant presentation. I'm sure you'll all agree, and you might like to put your hands together again for Kenneth. Can always rely on him to come up trumps, and what a brilliant finish. But we come to that stage where I'd like to call on Julie Sattler, who has a lot of titles, but Secretary of the Council of British and Commonwealth Societies is most appropriate for this evening, as well as Assistant Treasurer of the Royal Overseas League, and ask her to propose the Loyal Toast.
It's a great honour to be proposing this toast tonight in such a wonderful year of the Jubilee. I think when we think back about our Queen, we think, what other person do we know who's still working after 70 years and still carrying out their job with such grace and dignity? So if everyone could raise their glasses, please.
Stand
and raise. Yeah, they're doing that. The Queen.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. Now, Your Excellency and ladies and gentlemen, sorry to interrupt. Please start your dessert. It looks absolutely delicious. But we just want to go on with the next part, and I want to call on the new Deputy President of the Royal Overseas League and the continuing Treasurer of the Victorian branch, John Short, to say a few words of thanks in appreciation of the people who've contributed this evening.
Well, thank you, Jason, and on behalf of what I can probably say is the acting president tonight, and also the council members of the Victorian branch, and also all of the members and guests here tonight, I'd like to thank Your Excellency, the Honourable Linda Dessau, Governor of Victoria and Administrator of Australia, and Mr. Anthony Howard for joining us tonight in this celebration of Her Majesty the Queen's Platinum Jubilee. Your presence, your lovely speech tonight, and your involvement with all of us tonight has really made this evening very, very special. So we thank you very much for that. Talking about presentations, that was a wonderful presentation, Kenneth. I know you've had a couple of applause already, but thank you for sharing that wonderful photo gallery and all those lovely memories. So thank you very much again. It's wonderful again to be able to gather together as a community to celebrate such a special occasion. And I'd like to thank everyone here tonight who's joined us. And I think I've also got to have a special recognition too of Sally Robertson, who brought a lot of people to tonight's event. So thank you, Sally, for doing that. And I'd also like to thank you more generally for your support of the Royal Overseas League and the Victorian branch in particular. Now, functions such as these involve quite a lot of considerable organisation. And I'd like to invite you to join me in thanking Kia Watt, our branch secretary, for for the amazing work he's done in conjunction with our friends here at the RACV Club. And I'd like to thank Rebecca and the team here who have looked after us so well this evening in serving us and helping to make this evening very, very special. I'd also like to pay regard to the people of the RACV Club who contributed with Keir in terms of the organisation of tonight, and of course who prepared the lovely meal that we've all enjoyed tonight as well. So thank you very much. I think with such a lovely group of people here tonight, and we've talked a lot about rains, so I think it would also be appropriate tonight to recognise Jason Ronald, who's the past president, just past president of the Victorian branch of the Royal Overseas League and also chairman of Australia, which he assumed those roles for over 20 years. And there's a lot you can say about Jason, but one of the things that I would like to say is just his generosity in so many ways in which he supported the league. So thank you, Jason. Once again, I'd like to thank everyone for their support tonight. I look forward to seeing you at future events and functions of the league, and I wish you all safe travel home tonight and also continuing good health. Thank you. One special thing I've got to do. For the Governor, we've got a small token of our appreciation for your presence here.